Hello, my name is Yusra El-Ghalib. Welcome to my presentation about our new brain paper named Cognomon-I Gain-of-Function Mutations Differentially Affect Channel Gating and Cause Neurodevelopmental Disorders. The Cognomon-I gene codes for the CoV3.3 channel, which is a calcium channel belonging to the low-voltage activated T-type channels. These have a voltage dependence of activation near the resting membrane potential of nerve cells, where they are responsible for low threshold calcium spikes and regulate excitability and rhythmic activity of neuronal circuits. So far, CoV3.3 has only been linked to schizophrenia, but here in this paper, we studied four mutations found in patients with epilepsy and or intellectual disability. All mutated residues are located in or around the activation gate and introduce H-bonds that reduce the flexibility of the activation gate. This is expected to slow the opening and the closing of the gate upon activation and inactivation. We expressed the wild type and the mutated channels in Hex cells, and indeed we saw a slowing of the activation and inactivation of the mutant here in red as compared to the wild type here in blue. And this slowing of the inactivation is a gain of function mutation, which would result in a prolonged and therefore increased calcium influx upon neuronal depolarization. Another gain of function effect that we found was the left shift of the voltage dependence of activation to potentials even closer to the resting membrane potential of nerve cells, meaning that they respond to lower depolarizations and therefore have an increased excitability. And we see the same for the other three mutations. This left-shifted activation also affects the window current. And the window current is the overlapping area between the activation and the inactivation curves, as you can see here in blue for the wild type. This is basically the leak current at a certain voltage. And we know from literature that in CoV3.3, the window current is important to trigger spontaneous low threshold calcium spikes and for its role in rhythmic activity. We see that in the mutant, both the activation and the inactivation curves are left shifted and therefore result in a left shifted and even increased window current here in red for the mutant. This constant leak around the resting membrane potential increases the calcium influx in neurons expressing these mutant channels, which could then lead to calcium toxicity during neurodevelopment, explaining the intellectual disability. Increased leak current can also result in hyperexcitability, which could explain the seizures that we see in the epilepsy patients. CoV3.3 is expressed in NRT neurons here in the thalamocortical network, and an imbalance of the thalamocortical rhythms have been associated with epilepsy. Several gain-of-function mutations in CoV3.2, also expressed in NRT neurons, are linked to epilepsy and were shown to increase the NRT neuron excitability, which then results in an imbalance in the excitatory inhibitory, and this ultimately leads to seizures. So the question is, do we also see signs of hyperexcitability in our CoV3.3 mutations? To test this, we used a computer simulation of NRT neurons using the results from our own electrophysiology experiments, and we found that when you are comparing here in blue the wild type to here our example mutant in red, that there is an increased firing frequency, and as you can see here in this figure, there's a prolonged burst duration and also a lower firing threshold, as you can see here. And this indeed indicates hyperexcitability. Additionally, we also expressed our wild-type mutants in chromaffin cells, which are native excitable cells, and we saw again a lowering of the threshold, of the firing threshold in the mutants compared to the wild type. And additionally, we also saw a delayed decay of the calcium spikes, which then would result again in a prolonged calcium influx. So, to summarize, we found 4 gain of function mutants in the activation gate of CoV3.3 that result in an increased calcium influx, which could then lead to calcium toxicity, explaining the neurodevelopmental defects. We also saw proof for hyperexcitability, which explains the seizures. And additionally, the level of severity of each mutant on a biophysical level was in line with the patient phenotype severity. And last but not least, one of the epilepsy patients is now being treated successfully with an unspecific T-type blocker. And all of this makes CoV3.3 an attractive target for pharmacological treatment and, of course, for further investigation. With this, I want to thank all my colleagues in Innsbruck and all our collaborators around the world, and of course the clinicians and the patient families, and of course also our funding. Thank you for listening.